Thanks for having us today, myself and Maria. As I said, my name is Lizzie Kavanagh. I'm a senior occupational therapist working in P-Mountain. That's our new building. So that building's actually open since 2020. But our service is as I said, December 2022. So it's an inpatient service. Patients come in for 2 weeks and it's a 5-day programme. So they go home at the weekend. I suppose the goal of it is to optimise self-management of people living with rheumatic and musculoskeletal disease and increase functional independence in everyday life. And our patients are referred from rheumatology clinics, any healthcare professional within NACE General Hospital and Tala University Hospital as well. So there's a lot going on this morning with the meeting and getting here. So I just wanted to start with a little bit of relaxation, if that's all right. Okay, just do a couple of minutes, nothing much. Help you absorb all the information, hopefully in the next few slides. All right, I'm going to sit myself. Okay, all right. So begin making yourself comfortable, okay? Sit in the chair and allow your back to be straight, but not stiff. With your feet on the ground, your hands could be resting gently in your lap or at your side. Allow your eyes to close or to remain open with a soft gaze, whichever is comfortable for you. Take several long, slow, deep breaths, breathing in fully and exhaling slowly. Breathe in through your nose and out through your mouth. Feel your stomach expand on an inhale and relax and let go as you exhale. Begin to let go of noises around you. If you are distracted by sounds in the room, simply notice this and bring your focus back to your breathing. Now slowly bring your attention down to your feet. Observe sensations in your feet. Feel your toes against your socks or your shoes, and just notice this without judgment. You might imagine sending your breath down to your feet, as if the breath is traveling through the nose, to the lungs, through the abdomen, all the way down to your feet. And then back up again, out through your nose and your lungs. Perhaps you don't feel anything at all, and that is fine too. Just allow yourself to feel the sensation of not feeling anything. When you are ready, move your attention up to your ankles, your calves, your knees, and your thighs. Observe the sensations you're experiencing throughout your legs. Breathe into and out of your legs. If your mind begins to wander during this exercise, gently notice this without judgment and bring your mind back to your legs. If you notice any discomfort or pain or stiffness, don't judge this. Just simply notice it. Observe how all sensations rise and fall, shift and change moment to moment. Notice how no sensation is permanent. Just observe and allow the sensations to be in the moment, just as they are. Slowly move your attention up to your lower and upper back. And just be curious about the sensations here. You may become aware of sensations in the muscle, temperature, or points of contact with the furniture. And with each out breath, you may let go of any tension you are carrying here. As you continue to breathe, bring your awareness to your chest and your heart region and just notice your heartbeat. Observe how the chest rises during the inhale and how the chest falls during the exhale. Let go of any judgments that may arise. On the next out breath, shift the focus to your hands and your fingertips. See if you can channel your breathing into and out of this area, as if you are breathing into and out from your hands. If your mind wanders, gently bring it back to the sensations in your hands. Okay. Observe the sensations or lack of sensations through your arms. As you exhale, you may experience the arms soften and release any tension you're carrying here. Continue to breathe and shift focus to the neck and your shoulder region. And this is an area where we often have a lot of tension. Be with the sensations here. It could be tightness, rigidity, or holding. You may notice the shoulders moving along with the breath. Let go of any thoughts or stories you are telling about this area. As you breathe, you may feel the tension rolling from your shoulders. Now shift your focus and direct your attention to the head and to the face. Observe all the sensations occurring there. And as you exhale, you may notice the softening of any tension you might be holding here. And now, let your attention expand out to include the entire body as a whole. Feel the gentle rhythm of the breath as it moves through the body. And as you come to the end of this practice, take a full, deep breath, taking in all of the energy of this practice. Exhale fully. And when you are ready, start to bring your attention back to the room. You can wiggle your toes, your fingers, and just notice how you're feeling at the moment. And when you're ready, you can open your eyes and bring your attention back to the room. Okay?
Thank you.
We'll talk a little bit about how important it is to have this relaxation as a stress management tool throughout your day.
So thank you, Lizzie, that was lovely. I'll try not to be too harsh now in what I say after coming away from that relaxation. So just to talk about the new terminology about rheumatic and musculoskeletal diseases. These are a diverse group of diseases that commonly affect the joints but can affect any organ of the body. There are more than 200 different types of rheumatic and musculoskeletal diseases affecting both children and adults. And they are usually caused by problems of the immune system, inflammation, infections, or gradual deterioration of joints, muscles, and bones. And they are typically painful and limit function, which I don't need to tell you, I'm sure. So some of the common types are rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis, and gout. And according to estimates from the United Nations, symptomatic osteoarthritis affects about 15% of the people worldwide. Rheumatoid arthritis is the most common autoimmune inflammatory form of arthritis and affects 1 in 100 persons worldwide, with women affected twice as commonly as men, which is representative of our group here. Gout then is the most common cause of inflammatory arthritis in men and has a prevalence in the USA and Europe of about 4%. Less common types, so nobody feels left out, are spondyloarthropathies, such as psoriatic arthritis and ankylosing spondylitis. Other less common types are polymyalgia rheumatica, giant cell arthritis or temporal arthritis, vasculitis, Behçet's, Sjogren's or dermatomyositis. And then SLE or lupus affects women approximately 9 times more frequently than men and it's a systemic autoimmune disease. Frequently causes arthritis and dysfunction of the connective tissues, among other systemic manifestations. So the result of all of these RMDs, we'll call them, is that there's a significant reduction in function and quality of life, as well as increased disability. So early action. So all of the international, European and American agencies involved in rheumatology are eager that people are diagnosed as soon as possible, so that treatment can be started early and it prevents or limits long-term consequences, which is really important, obviously. So EULAR started the awareness campaign in 2017 about don't delay and connect today. And this isn't just for people with symptoms, this is for GPs and medical professions to take enough interest to have people diagnosed as early as possible. And when that happens, treatment options are started and trialled so that your condition comes into a state of remission or very low disease activity as soon as possible, which has better outcome for you. So the guidelines that we follow, evidence-based guidelines, deal with two different areas. And these are the pharmacological management of your condition and the non-pharmacological management. And these go hand in hand. It's not one or the other. It's always a combination of both to get the best outcome for you. And education is the starting point. And you're already bought into that idea because you're here today and you're involved in your Arthritis Ireland branch, which is excellent. Because self-management can be complicated and involve lots of different aspects and ideas. But education around your condition and how best to manage it can set you up with the tools that you need. And hopefully we'll discuss some of them this morning.
So, things that we'll talk about today. Joint protection, the importance around protecting those vulnerable joints in everyday life. Looking at aids and appliances and footwear. Pacing ourselves and managing our daily routines. Physical activity and exercise will really, it's a key part that we love to market in this area. Stress management, sleep and fatigue management, look at diet, looking at smoking and the impacts on alcohol as well. And finish with a little bit of tips around managing pain and flare management, okay. So we talk a lot about, in our program, we talk a lot about the pain cycle, and some of these elements might be familiar to many of you. So if someone has, I suppose, persistent pain, it can lead you to be less active, lead you to less loss of fitness, muscle weakness, and increased stiffness. And that might also correspond with sleep problems and tiredness, and stress and fear, frustration. There's side effects that come with medications as well. Weight gain, mood, impact your mood, time off work, and then there's money concerns with that. And also can impact relationships. And I suppose just what Maria was saying in terms of self-management, and it can be complex in trying to increase, you know, look at our self-management because all of these elements can interplay with each other. But what we look at is how do we make that cycle of pain into a cycle of gain, and we try to interrupt that cycle in some area. So by doing that, we look at pacing, sleep hygiene, protecting our joints, stress management, moving, exercise, looking at how we manage our pain, how we look at our pain, looking at those social connections, which are fantastic for our overall good well-being. All right. So we'll just look at trying to interrupt that cycle of pain and looking at these elements. And somewhere we'll start is joint protection. It's a really key part of managing our lifestyle, managing our daily routine, and living with arthritis if you have vulnerable joints. So what it is joint protection includes applying ergonomic principles in daily life, and it's altering those working methods using assistive devices, which we'll mention, and modifying our environments. Okay, if you have very vulnerable joints, if you have sore joints, which many of you do living with arthritis, and if you stress that in doing everyday activities, if you put stress and strain on those vulnerable joints, it's more likely to obviously be painful, more stress and inflamed. But if you reduce that stress by protecting those joints, by using the principles which we'll mention, the pain and inflammation will decrease in conditions in particular with inflammatory arthritis and osteoarthritis. So think about our joint protection principles. So number one is distribute weight over several joints. And in practice, for example, if we're carrying our shopping bags, those ones that you get kind of the small little handle that you get at the shop, we might be putting a lot of strain on those smaller joints that might be a bit sore. But if you get, say, a shopping bag with, that's for stronger and larger joints. If you have a shopping bag that has a longer strap, and you have longer ones, you could put it on your elbow or your shoulder or your other shoulder. So you're using your stronger joints. Sorry, I skipped on. But weight over several joints. If you're carrying a pot in your kitchen, and you're carrying the handle with one hand, you're putting a lot of strain there on your wrist and your thumb. But say if you have oven gloves or even miracle gloves that you can get, say, in Home Store Morrissey, they're like gardening gloves, you can use both of your hands for transferring that item. Or kettle, you can have a cloth under the kettle and you're using more of your joints to transfer the object, if that makes sense. Now, reducing the effort, so use a gadget, which we'll mention in the next slide. Slide, don't lift, use your wheels. Reduce the weight of the object. Again, going back to the classic kettle, we use it every day. Only put as much water in it as you need. You don't need to overfill it, or even shopping bags, reducing the weight of objects. Do you need to pack all your shopping into two bags and you're putting a lot of strain on your joints? Use a trolley and have more bags and you're reducing the weight of it. Avoid tight grips. So when you're writing and cutlery, can you get a pen with a bigger grip? Or have a pencil grip you get in stationery that just kind of make that wider grip and release the tension, reduce the tension on your smaller joints. And avoid limit positions of deformity. And that's say, twisting, tearing, pinching, that might put strain on those vulnerable joints. And I'll mention certain ways of doing that maybe in the next slide. And maintaining strength. So it's a kind of a balance between, say, using your splints and protecting your joints and ensuring that your joints are protected in activities every day. But there's also keeping your hands mobile. And you know, if you're given a splint to protect those vulnerable joints, there's little hand exercises to maintain the strength as much as possible in the joints as well. So it's maintaining the muscle there too. So mentioned there, avoiding twisting and tearing. So I don't know if many of you are familiar with the Dysum, the non-slip material. So instead of gripping it and putting strain on those smaller joints and twisting, that you use the palm of your hand and it's just protecting those joints. These easy grip scissors, avoid those cheese packets, the cereal packets, that tearing, that does it for you. Doesn't mean you don't have to do it. And ring pull openers, and I say increase the grip on your utensils. There's an OXO range, there's non-slip, and it's bigger material, so it's really helpful in cutlery. All right, there's some. I just popped in the steamer, and the air fryers are great too. Steamer means that you don't have to take out the water and have that, you know, this might be sore on your wrist, you just take it out with a spoon. Okay, and the Ninja is great too, or the, not Ninja, the air fryer.
This is not a sponsored advertisement. So we know 90% of people with inflammatory arthritis have foot pain, and a lot of times that's where the symptoms of your condition begins. We also know that a lot of people have a lot of shame around their feet and deformities of the feet, so don't tend to mention it to their health professional, so it's really important that you do. We know that there's different types of footwear and insoles that you can get that might make your feet more comfortable. So I'm just going to talk this morning about the different aspects of a shoe that you should look at when you're buying your own footwear. So a wide deep toe box, so that means across from where your big toe goes to your little toe, that you ensure that space in your runner is wide enough to accommodate your feet and to make sure that there's no rubbing of your feet off the side of the shoe. A lot of shoes have a very tapered toe box or narrow toe box, so that'd be one feature definitely to look at in terms of comfort. The other thing would be to have adjustable fastenings on your shoe, so that if there's a day where your feet, your ankles are a little bit swollen, that the fastenings can accommodate that. Whereas maybe more rigid shoe or something that has to be tied isn't as good. Obviously easy to put on and off. Now that comes at a compromise, because an easy to put on and off shoe isn't necessarily the most stable shoe for you. So you need to weigh up how it'll affect your hands putting on and off a difficult shoe. Should be breathable material, Comfortable upper material. So the material at the top of your footwear should be soft, because oftentimes we get a little bit of clawing of the toes, and one toe can stick up a little bit higher than another, and it can chafe off the top. Yeah, so we've all experienced that, lots of nodding. Okay, so make sure that, that material at the top is soft, so that you're not going to get a lot of friction between a toe or a clawed toe that sticks up a little bit higher. And then a removable insole, because as I've mentioned, there are different types of insoles that can make your footwear more comfortable. So if you are buying a runner or a shoe, make sure that the insole inside it comes out, because if you go and get customized insoles, that makes the shoe very tight if the insole of the runner or shoe doesn't come out. Okay, so they're things to look at. And then no seams over pressure areas to avoid rubbing and chafing, because we don't want a sore as well on top of our skin as well as a sore foot. Okay. And then healthcare professionals may be able to recommend certain shoes to help people with arthritis, and that's all the different types of arthritis.
Okay, so look at managing your fatigue, but also, I suppose, managing your pain as well. We talk a lot about pacing, planning, and prioritizing the three P's, and I think people who come to our program are very familiar with pacing in particular. So what is pacing? So for example, on a Saturday morning, you might need to do the hoovering upstairs and downstairs, you need to go do a shop, you need to put a wash on, you also need to meet a friend for coffee. And afterwards you come home from doing all that in the Saturday afternoon and you're wrecked and you're in pain and your joints are sore. So you've peaked and now you're in this trough area where you need that rest that might be too long and you haven't the energy or you're not able for the things that are actually more meaningful to you. So you've peaked and now you're in this trough. So what you want to avoid is that peak and that trough, okay? So how do we do that? We look at trying to balance activity and rest and disperse it throughout the day and the week. Take those micro breaks. So say if you're, I'm going back to domestic tasks because it's relevant for all of us, I think. If you're going to say do the hoovering downstairs, or I'm going to do two or three rooms and I'm going to put a timer on, I'm going to do that, and I'm going to take my break and have a cup of tea and then I'll go back to it, instead of having the pain and being wrecked after all of it, okay? And it's best to stop for a break before you reach that period, and that can be difficult, but I suppose it takes a bit of reflection and it takes a bit of putting a timer on and being strict with yourself and knowing your limit. And balance the heavy and light tasks throughout the day and the week. For example, if you are going back to hoovering, if you do, say, a little bit of hoovering, maybe follow it with, say, a little bit of dusting, or, you know, back to back. So it's kind of a heavier task with a lighter task. But everyone's different, and that level of task is very different to individuals, all right? But how do we pace? And it can be difficult without planning. You really need to be able to plan. I had to put a man doing all of this. Yeah, I had to do that now. An activity diary. So that is something that really helps you to be able to pace, helps you to see and slot, I suppose, different activities throughout the week. It means that you can see on Thursday, I have a social event there that's really important to me, and I can do maybe do a wash maybe the day before, or, you know, so you can protect the time around that activity that's meaningful for you, so you can plan ahead and you know what's to come. Create routines, spread activities out, and keep items you need together in an easy reach. So for a certain task, you have all of I keep going back to domestic, but all the window washing in the same area, or the mopping in a certain area, right? So just what you need for each task in that's easy reach for you. Look for equipment to reduce effort, and I suppose that's thinking about the steamer or the air fryer, things that just reduce the effort of a certain task for you, and measure and track your energy use. And that's where the activity diary can be really handy, I suppose. If, you know, sometimes people don't realize the impact of an activity on you until maybe just after it, or maybe a day later, or maybe throughout it. So it's different depending on the activity. So it's kind of difficult to reflect on what the impact is. So that activity diary not only allows you to plan ahead, but also kind of gets you to reflect on the impact on certain activities. And also, I think, prioritize. And some questions to help you to prioritize. What do I need to do? What do I want to do today? What can be put off until another day? What can I ask someone else to do for me? How can I delegate? What activities help me feel energized? And sometimes we kind of deprioritize those things. Is it meeting a friend? Is it meeting family? Is it going to yoga? Is it going to Tai Chi? What energizes me? So I need to prioritize that for my day rather than clean the windows, you know? Learn to say no and prioritize your health. And I think it's relevant for all of us, really, that some of us find it hard to say no because we don't want to miss an opportunity. But remember that by saying no to one thing, you are saying yes to something else that you might value more, okay? Right.
Okay, so in terms of the guidelines that we follow, again, evidence-based guidelines, we should actively promote physical activity and exercise at the point at which you are diagnosed and regularly thereafter. So here we are doing that. Physical activity can be really important to help you keep well and retain movement in your joints. Some people might need to see a physiotherapist one-on-one to help them with physical activity, and other people can join suitable exercise programs. So for example, aqua aerobics, swimming, dancing, yoga or Pilates. Your healthcare team should talk to you about staying active and may refer you to a specialist if you need it. So why? Why do we talk about physical activity and exercise? The American Guidelines on Physical Activity published this in August 2020. So a single bout of moderate to vigorous physical activity provides immediate benefits for your health. So those benefits include improving your sleep quality, reducing your anxiety, and reducing your blood pressure. And there's an emerging body of evidence that suggests physical activity might help boost your immune system. And of course, with autoimmune conditions, we want every opportunity to boost our immune system in a positive way. Some of the longer term outcomes of physical activity for adults include reducing the risk of developing dementia and reduces the risk of depression. It lowers the risk of heart disease, stroke, and type 2 diabetes. It lowers the risk of 8 cancers, including bladder, breast, colon, endometrium, esophagus, kidney, lung, and stomach. It reduces weight gain, it improves bone health, and it reduces the risk of falls. So a question I always ask is, if it was a pill, would you buy it? Yes, except it doesn't really cost anything, and there's very few side effects. So the guidelines suggest then that adults with arthritis should aim for at least 150 minutes a week of moderate intensity exercise. So the same as everybody else. You should aim also for at least 2 days a week of strengthening or balance exercises, okay? Now, 150 minutes sounds like a lot. Usually it's recommended you break that up into 30-minute slots. But for a lot of people who've sore joints or may suffer from fatigue, smaller blocks of exercise is fine. You're looking at the cumulative effect over 150 minutes. You may not get the same benefits from a cardiovascular point of view, but it's still better than not doing any. Okay, so I don't want that 150 minutes or the 530 minutes to turn anybody off. So we talk about moderate intensity exercise to get optimum benefit, okay? How would you think about calculating that? So for anyone who knows any gym bunnies, they might have polar monitors or their Fitbits or things like that. So you're looking at 64 to 76% of your maximum heart rate. Now, I presume you're not going to get out your calculators and figure that out. So the easiest way to remember that is you should exercise at a pace where you can talk but you can't sing, okay? So you should be a little bit breathless, okay? That's easy to remember. You should be a little bit breathless, you should be working a little bit hard, but you're not able to sing a song. We're not doing Beyonce on it, we're not on stage dance. Okay, and the types of exercise then are aerobic exercise, resistance, which is your strengthening exercise, balance exercise, and some flexibility exercises as well, okay? Some of the things I hear on a regular basis is, I don't have enough time to exercise. Okay, we all use that, we all do. The weather. Now, yesterday I mightn't have been encouraging anybody to go out for a walk. So you might need an alternative venue to exercise on a day like yesterday. But in general, there's no such thing as bad weather. It's just bad clothing or footwear or whatever it might be. And we do live in Ireland, so You can't keep using it as an excuse. Fear avoidance is another big thing. So you may have had an experience where maybe you've joined a class, you've exercised with someone who is much fitter than you and doesn't have arthritis, or there's, you know, you might have flared up your symptoms from doing maybe the wrong type of exercise or the wrong intensity of exercise. So everybody has an element of fear avoidance about some type of exercise. And it's important to just think about that, analyze it, and try something different or at a different pace. Educating yourself and information is really important. So again, we're talking about that today. And then there's the fear of flaring up your pain, increasing your stiffness and increasing your swelling. But most of the evidence suggests if you get it right, as in do the right amount and the right intensity and the right type, you're not going to influence your pain, stiffness and swelling in a negative way. So there's loads of strong evidence to support this. Studies show that physical activity can reduce your pain, improve your function, your mood and quality of life. And we all want that. So tips to get started or to get restarted, because we understand with flare-up we might tend to fall off a little bit and not get back to what we want to do. So you think about the frequency. How regularly are you going to do it? What's going to work for you? Are you going to do 3 blocks of 10-minute exercise a day, or 2 blocks of 15, or just 30 minutes work for you without irritating your symptoms? The intensity, so moderate intensity. You can talk, but you can't sing, okay? The type of exercise, choose something you enjoy if possible, okay? And the duration, again, we were talking about that. If you get that right, pain, stiffness, fatigue, and injury are unlikely. Exercise and physical activity must be complemented by good sleep, good nutrition, and good hydration. Use mobility aids if prescribed. And we talked about footwear, and always wear comfortable clothing, so nothing you're going to trip up or fall over, especially. Listen to your body, because yours is different to everybody else's, okay? So you have to listen to what you're saying. Start low and go slow. So that's something, if you have maybe 5 years ago where you were able to do a certain thing, or maybe even last year you were able to do a certain thing, and that's where you envisage yourself getting back to, it's important that you start back at the beginning and ramp up very slowly rather than jumping in where you were a year ago, because that's just going to frustrate you. If experiencing a flare of pain, stiffness and swelling, taper back your program. Don't stop it, okay? And then gradually ramp it back up slowly when things are more under control. And if choosing an exercise partner or a group, choose wisely. It's really important. Okay, so now we're going to do a bit of movement. Sorry, lads. I will turn on some music. Now, I want everybody to join in here. Okay, I can see you all. All right, so we're going to start off with our feet. As I said, 90% of people with inflammatory arthritis will get foot pain. So it's important to keep your feet flexible and strong, okay? And also there can be pain in the back of the Achilles tendon sometimes, and again, this is a good exercise to keep them strong. So just very gently lifting, you time and listen, lifting the heels up and down off the floor. And go as high as you can on the ball of your feet. Good. So Lizzie's timing us, we're only going to do 50 seconds of each exercise. And you can make this harder if you like. So you could stand up at home doing this exercise if it felt okay for your feet, or you could do it on one leg. Okay. Not too bad, is it? Okay, we're going to move up to the bigger muscles of our legs. So these guys are really important to help us stand up, sit down, go up and down the stairs, or with our balance. So very simply, just gently kicking out. Good. So you're probably starting to feel that on your quads there a little bit, yeah? And we can make this exercise harder by standing up or sitting down from the chair, by adding a weight to your ankle. There's lots of ways of making it harder, but we'll stick with this for today. Are we at 30?
Yeah.
Change leg. You have a heavy shoe on. She has time. Okay, so back pain is a huge feature for us and for the general population. So if you want to perch out at the edge of your seats, we're just going to do a little movement of your back, okay? So first of all, we'll sit up as tall as we can, so the tallest version of ourselves. And then we're going to tuck the tailbone in and slouch your lower back, then your middle back, then your upper back, and then your head and neck. Good. And then we're going to stack the bones of the spine on top of each other. So we're sticking the tailbone out. We're stacking up through the lower back, the middle back, the upper back, and the head and neck. And continue like that. So we're slouching like a slinky. That's it, all the way down. And then stacking up, coming up nice and tall through your lower back, middle back, upper back, and head and neck. Great. Okay, so we're going to do the arms. And a lot of us, after a certain period of our life, forget to move our arms over our head. And we get a lot of pain sometimes because our muscles aren't used to moving us up over our head. Okay. Now, if that's very uncomfortable, you can move your arms just out in front of your chest. Okay, so we don't want to make anybody uncomfortable. And if you're at home and you want to add a tin of beans to each hand, or a bottle of water, or if you're feeling pretty strong, your litre of milk, that's a very easy way of keeping your arms and your shoulders nice and strong. Okay, the last one is balance. And we lose our balance the less we challenge it. So I'd encourage you all, when you're boiling the kettle for a cup of tea, stand at your countertop and challenge your balance. So we're going to do that now. So you're standing, chairs in front of you, so hover the hands over in front of it. Okay, we can either stand with one foot in front of the other if your balance is a little bit shaky, or we can stand on one foot. And just using your hands to steady you if you need it. But you're very good. Yeah, and change legs then. I bet you all started with your good leg. That's great. Nearly there. Well done. Okay, so what that shows us is that 5 minutes exercise is very manageable. And all you'd need to do is to repeat that sequence three times to get 15 minutes exercise in. So that's just a little taster. Okay, and just to remember that some physical activity is better than none. Okay, no matter how slow you go, you're still lapping everybody on the couch. Okay, so that's a good motivation to get out.
Okay, moving on to stress management, and it's a really key part of an element that we need to look at when we're looking at our lifestyle management, especially living with a chronic condition. Okay, so stress has a reciprocal relationship with arthritis. Stress can contribute to arthritis, and arthritis can contribute to stress. So if we think about negative thinking, this can activate the limbic system when we ruminate over past threats or worry about future ones. So your body's stress response triggers the release of certain chemicals that ready you to face that challenge at hand. Your breathing quickens, your heart rate increases, and your muscles tense in preparation. I think myself and Maria definitely felt this morning coming in here. And this reaction is fine for the short term because it readies you to face that challenge. But in the long term, if this fires repeatedly, that tension in your muscles can amplify arthritic pain, okay, and joint pain. And also stress sets off this immune system's inflammatory response in specific in conditions, say in rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis, okay? So it's really important to manage our stress and find a way, an individual personal way of managing our stress. So thinking about relaxation strategies, we tried one there early on, and I think there's loads of evidence now, particularly with people living with chronic pain. I suppose it integrates the mind and the body, and it has benefits on both. And it can have improvements in pain intensity. But it's very easily resourced. All you need is your mind and your breath, really. Possibly a quiet room. And there's lots of resources, free resources online. There's on the Arthritis Ireland website, there's a lovely body scan too that's available to you for free, on Spotify as well. Okay, there's other ones as well. So deep breathing is a form of mindfulness meditation, progressive muscle relaxation. I suppose it's a guided meditation where you're tensing your muscles and you're releasing them. So it helps you to identify if there's any tension in your muscles. Visualization, yoga, Tai Chi, and a hobby you enjoy. And that's individual and very personal. For me, it's doing a puzzle. You lose yourself in an activity, and it's a relaxation strategy, but it's very personal to you. And it's finding that flow where you lose yourself in an activity that's meaningful for you. So how do we do it? Some tips on trying to build a habit around prioritizing time and going back to that planning piece and in the exercise as well, it's setting aside time in your daily schedule, okay? Don't practice when you're sleepy. They say they don't get as much out of it. And obviously choose a technique that appeals to you, and it's the same with exercise. Choose a form of exercise that appeals to you. So it's more realistic, isn't it, for you to continue yourself. Sleep. And sleep is an area that many people find difficult, and it can, you know, it can be impacted by stress as well. I suppose it's a relationship with all the elements we talked in the pain cycle. But some tips to, I suppose, improve that, your sleep hygiene is what we call it. So ensure that your routine is as regular as possible. You go to bed at the same time roughly, and you wake up at the same time roughly as well. If you're finding trouble to get to sleep in the first place, get out maybe after 20 minutes, half an hour, do something boring, read a book or listen to some music, and get back and try again. Instead of tossing and turning, we might be hurting our joints as well in that form. I see a lot of nodding heads. Avoid caffeine, alcohol, nicotine before bed. I think maybe it's an Irish thing. I suppose we love our cups of tea in the evening time, and before we even think about it, we might have had two or three. But it's a comfort mechanism, I think, for many of us. So just think about, you know, that tea and that routine. Do I need to switch to decaf, or, you know, just having to think about that. Avoiding naps, and that's, I suppose, in the circumstance if you're someone that naps during the day and you're having trouble sleeping at night time, you know, it's just kind of have a think about that might be impacting your quality of sleep at night time. But some people need to have the nap during the day and sleep absolutely wonderfully throughout the night time too. If it's safe to do so, and if you have a bath 1 to 2 hours prior to going to bed, it helps with relaxing. And some maybe Epsom salts or things like that, some scented, just to help with that relaxation prior to bed. Using a sleep diary might help you to reflect on the routine around your sleep and what's going on. Ensure it's the right space, of course, and ensure it's comfortable, ensure it's quiet, curtains dark, and appropriate for that. And exercise, obviously not prior to going to bed, but exercise during the day can also help with that quality of sleep as well at night time.
So yeah, we can't talk about lifestyle without including these factors, so this is non-judgmental, but we do need to include them. So we're talking about the diet. We talk about the colours of the rainbow, so try and include the colours of the rainbow into your diet. A healthy, balanced diet is integral to lifestyle improvement. Consuming specific food types is unlikely to have a large benefit. So big guidelines will steer away from telling you to give up certain food groups or just eat certain food groups. So a balance across the board is very important. Aim for a healthy weight and work with health professionals to achieve controlled and intentional weight loss through healthy diet and increased physical activity. So it would be important maybe not to rule out dairy because of your bones, to not rule out meat because also we need protein to build muscle and bones as well. So that's really important not to rule out major categories without getting advice from a dietitian. So the advice around cigarette smoking is don't smoke or stop smoking. So smoking is detrimental to symptoms, function, disease activity, disease progression, and the occurrence of all the other conditions that can come with smoking. People with rheumatoid arthritis should be aware that smoking may affect disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. So if you smoke, it affects the way that your body will absorb your medication that you're taking to help your condition. Alcohol consumption. So the WHO would say there's no level of healthy alcohol consumption, but the guidelines suggest that a low level of alcohol consumption is unlikely to negatively impact RMD outcomes, except in certain situations. So people with rheumatoid arthritis should be aware that moderate alcohol consumption is associated with increased risk of rheumatoid arthritis flare and comorbidities. And people with gout should be aware that moderate alcohol consumption is associated with an increased risk of gout flare. So if you are going to consume, a low level is what's suggested.
Okay, so thinking about work, and the guidelines would say that work participation may have benefits, beneficial effects on health outcomes of people living with rheumatic and musculoskeletal disease. And I just wanted to highlight there's a new service available in Kildare, so it's WorkAble Solutions. And it's a new service run by a clinical specialist occupational therapist based in Naas, and she travels around actually to some of the primary care services in Kildare. So it's for people who are experiencing difficulty at work or who are out of work less than 6 months. So unfortunately, they're not included if they're over 6 months. Okay, so if someone or you know someone with rheumatic and musculoskeletal disease who are finding work really challenging associated with the condition, you can ask for a GP referral or a referral from your primary care healthcare professional for a referral. And I suppose all individuals with an RMD living in the Kildare West Wicklow area or outside of this catchment, if attending the rheumatology team in Naas Hospital. And if you have any specific queries around that, just come to me afterwards and we can chat about it, all right?
So pain management is an area that we could go on about forever, and we're not going to talk about the pharmacological aspect of it or the medication aspect of it. But just to notice that with rheumatology conditions, oftentimes there can be an element of pain sensitivity that sets in that's not always associated with the level of inflammation that you might have or the level of injury in a joint. And there's various terms that are used for this, such as fibromyalgia syndrome or pain amplification. So this is where the nervous system has lowered its threshold to perceiving pain. So you feel pain more readily. Your body is used to pain, it has a memory of pain, so you feel it more readily. So there are some factors that might amplify pain for you, and there are some tools and strategies that can dim the pain. Now we could go on forever about this, but I'm simplifying it there. So I suppose we're used to an old model back in the 1600s of pain where you hurt yourself and you get pain, and it's as simple as that. The tissue heals and it's gone. But we know now that it's a much more complicated picture in relation to pain. And there are lots of things that affect it. So your joint itself might have become more sensitive or sensitized. Your central nervous system might have become more sensitive or sensitized. Your immune system is involved. Your ability to learn things is involved. Your beliefs and your previous experiences are involved in how much pain you feel. You have a memory of pain, and your brain is really good at storing those memories and replaying them over again. And stress has a huge impact on the amount of pain that you experience, okay? So it's not straightforward, it's not black and white. So there are many things, most of which we've discussed today, that will help with pain management as well as managing your arthritic condition. And these are medication, sleep, exercise, rest, relaxation, diet, nutrition, weight management, joint protection, and engaging in meaningful activity. And all of these have the capacity to help dim the pain that you might have that is more sensitive.
Okay, I suppose just to, we're nearly finished now, but just I suppose to look at flare management. I suppose the nature, unfortunately, of the condition, we have roller coasters, we're up and down, we have really good days, we have really, really challenging days as well, and that is the nature of it. But it's really important to know that what you can do can impact the frequency, the severity, and the length of each flare. All right, and I think everyone living with the rheumatic and musculoskeletal disease should have a toolbox, okay, and know what works for them, know what helps them during that time. So, for example, some people love the heat, some people love the cold. If you love the heat, have a hot water bottle, have a cozy for your hands that you can put in the microwave, or use your splints and use your compression gloves if they're prescribed. The three P's, we don't need to talk much more about that, but that is a really key time as well to use the three P's, the pacing, the planning, prioritising. They also obviously reduce the risk of flaring as well if you're able to put that in place. Using your stress management, use your relaxation strategy on those more challenging days as well. Motion is lotion, that sounds really cheesy, but exercise really, and even on your challenging days when you're feeling more tired and you're a little bit pained, gentle movements as well. Avoid sitting and prolonged sitting and prolonged lying for a good bit of time. What we say as well in our program is go to the pain, not through the pain. People kind of just get on with it and fight through it, and this isn't a condition where we do that, okay? So we need to respect the pain too. As I said, use your splints and your eyes and gloves as prescribed, and your protection principles reduce that strain. So it's all in trying to prevent it, and also during that time as well. We talked a lot about elements of our lifestyle, and we talked about a huge amount of things, we're not saying to go out and make a change right now, but in everything, just have a look at a certain amount. How you make a goal, say I'm going to be specific to meditation and relaxation. So we would say for people to make them smart, so that they're more achievable. So for example, specific. Be clear and specific on your goals so that they're easier to achieve, and this also helps you know how and where to get started. So I'm going to do maybe just some meditation. Measurable. Make sure that they are tracked, allowing you to see progress. They also tell you when a goal is complete. So for example, I'm going to do three 10-minute sessions for the week, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And you know at the end of that is achieved. Actionable, make sure that you are in control of it. Make sure it's you, you're in control of achieving it and carrying it out. Make sure it's realistic. Don't go in and say, I'm going to do an hour of meditation every day. It's not realistic. It's not going to be achievable. Might be achievable for some people, but it might not be achievable for everybody. Just make sure it's realistic for you and start small, I would say. And time bound. A date helps us to stay focused and motivated, inspiring us and providing something to work towards. Okay.
So we're going to wind up now on this slide. But it's just to encourage you, and I know you're already well on the road being part of your Kildare branch, but to be an expert in your own condition is really important. To get information from reliable sources, to educate yourself and maybe educate your family and others about your condition and the different types of conditions, and communicate. So use your helpline, use your branches, and use your support groups to communicate with people, because with a chronic condition there can be an element of isolation, and that's not good for your overall health. So ensure that you continue to communicate with each other and with the wider community, because information is key to self-management. And these are some resources that we use quite often, but certainly as a person with a rheumatic or musculoskeletal condition can find out lots of information. And including some of the podcasts there, which are really useful. Listen, if you're driving in the car or have a few minutes going out for your walk, they're a good listen, and loads of really reliable evidence-based information in those. Okay. Yeah, thanks, guys.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
We have questions. Thank you.